So we have with us Anirudh Ramesh, CA, All India Rank 28 of the Chartered Accountancy exam. I'm sure each and every time people will address his name, the rank would always be associated with it. And I'm sure there's a story to it, there's a story to share for it. And we wanted your thoughts on how you must have, you know, how you carried your journey throughout the entire, you know, your entire process for the entire Chartered Accountancy exam. There are a lot of papers to finish off and stuff like that.
Right.
Your thoughts on, we wanted your thoughts on a lot of the things that we wanted to ask, the questions that we wanted to ask. Over to you.
Sure, thanks Abhinav. Thanks also for having me here. So I think this is a great platform to share behind the scenes stories, something that people don't actually, you know, have access to. So coming up with that, I'll probably start off with telling everyone, you know, that doing the Chartered Accountancy course and finishing it off. So I started in 2016. I finished in 2020, along with my undergraduation, right? So the course is something that I never wanted to get into, right? Which happens with a lot of people out there, their parents push them into it for some reason. That didn't happen with me. It was purely my own choice when I didn't want to get into the course itself, because I was hoping to get into foreign universities, precisely the National University of Singapore to start off. So I applied and there was a merit cutoff in the sense that it's based on board marks to start off. I had qualified for the first round. The second round was approximately in July 2016. So as we know, we finish our boards by March. We get our results in May, right? But in the meantime, I had to join a college because I didn't get anywhere else, right? So Christ University in Bangalore was a place where I started joining. I actually started attending classes as well. And that was when I was waiting for my NUS results. So I was, like I said, I had started my CA CPT in 2016, cleared in my first attempt. And that is when I got serious in the sense that, you know, it's something that I enjoy doing, right?
Okay.
Solving accounts and law and audit as a whole is something that I enjoy doing. So for people who don't know the course, right, I'll probably explain the course in a brief manner. It's you have three levels: foundation, intermediate, and final. Your foundation is probably can be started in your first year of undergraduation itself. Your intermediate is 9 months after you write foundation. So essentially, I wrote in December 2016 my foundation exams. My intermediate was in November 2017 in my second year of undergraduation. After you finish your intermediate, so here I missed a rank, an All India rank by 13 marks, right? But it didn't really affect me that time because for me, getting so much was a big milestone in itself. So it didn't really bother or affect me that I did not cross that rank barrier, right? But the people around me felt that, you know, this person is probably capable of getting a rank, and it actually holds a lot of value on the resume when you apply for jobs or anything of that sort. So in CA, you have something called articleship where you intern for 3 years with a firm. If you've heard of the big fours, say KPMG, Deloitte, PwC, EY, or any other mid-sized firms in India, you have to article with them for 3 years before you write your final examinations.
Okay.
So November 2017 was my intermediate. I cleared that in Jan 2018. I joined Deloitte in my second year of undergraduation.
Okay.
Worked there for a good 2.5 years. Wrote my final exams in November 20. Hopefully, and with, you know, with the pandemic going on and everything, I was lucky enough to probably have stay at home in Chennai, where I'm from, and clear the exams. So I think all these pieces, small pieces, came together, which culminated in me getting a rank. And it's not the end of the story, because this is where I think the journey starts. From someone who really did not want to pursue the course today to someone who's qualified and is extremely happy that things worked out this way, right?
Yeah.
I think the story to everyone is that you don't have to have a plan. Things will fall into place, and you'll probably not regret doing what you did. Even if I didn't clear it in the first attempt, right, I probably have no regrets, because I know for a fact that this is something that I actually am interested in pursuing. So overall, the journey has been, it's been a roller coaster, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right from 2016 to 2021, it's been a high speed, probably a reverse going roller coaster, but I've thoroughly enjoyed.
Right. You've also answered almost like the second question that we wanted to ask you automatically. And I'll just ask you the question again, and I'll frame it a little in a different way, if I can. So in your entire journey, right, and if you had to convert your entire 4 to 5 year journey, it's definitely more than that. Getting into that 4-5 year journey, you definitely need a back journey for that as well. But if you wanted to convert your journey into like a short synopsis, how would you pen it down, and what part of the journey would you specifically stress? what part of the journey would you think it this was one of the most important thing that happened during the course of the journey, because this really helped me get where I am today?
All right. So I think a huge shout out to Christ University, where I went to for my undergraduate, because it was a place that was completely different to where I'd grown up in. I think we'll touch upon that later. Okay. But then the whole aspect of going to college, right? Because people who do CA, essentially, right? It's not like engineering where you go for a 4-year course, then you probably pursue an MBA or a master's. Mm-hmm. People who do CA do not go to college, and they do not go to a regular college. It's very rare. 10% people go to regular colleges, right? So for Christ, I had 85% attendance requirements every single semester, right? Mm-hmm. So classes went on from 6:30 in the morning to 11. Mm-hmm. And then I had my CA coaching from 12 to 5:30 in the evening. So the best part about it was everything was in the same place. The worst part is I was studying the whole day, right? And the second best part is Christ in Bangalore has an insane social life. If you are someone who's outgoing, who can speak and connect to people, you will find it to be one of the best colleges in the country, because you have people from all parts of India coming in. And right. I think I've personally grown so much as a person. If I probably went in at 1x in 2016, I came out at like 100 or 1000x in terms of the confidence that I probably have, in terms of my oratory skills, right, or the way to just connect with people, right? So networking, definitely. Out of this whole journey, I would say my second and third year at Christ, 2017 to 2019, right, where I probably had made a lot of friends who I still talk to, who I'm definitely in touch with, and right, people I will continue to be in touch with, like throughout my career, throughout my life. For I sure. think I would kill someone to go back to those days, honestly. I probably, cleared my exams and I'm in a better professional. I'm in a better professional area right now, but college, I mean, I feel bad for y'all that, you're sitting at home and attending classes, but attending so college.
You loved the entire process of getting there, right? Right.
It was insane beyond doubt, honestly.
Right.
I wanted to ask one thing. You hit a very sweet spot on where you mentioned that most commerce going undergraduates specifically trying to pursue chartered accountancy, or for that matter, even any other professional course, professional accredited course, mm-hmm, right? They do not find the compulsion to go to college, right? I think, why is it so? Why does it feel, why do you think personally that, they don't need there's no compulsion to go to college? Even a lot of our batchmates, mine and Fuzzles, they're also very, many of them just didn't choose to go to college, trying to pursue just solid CA, only CA, sitting at home in Oman and just pursuing CA properly. Mm-hmm. Why do you think there's no compulsion to go to college? Because college, like you mentioned, has a huge, growth spurt with the way you network and the way you try to develop a lot of skills. But why do you think this is the case with a lot of the...
Why is that the culture, right?
Because
a lot of people are very competitive in terms of, I want to be the first one at 21 years old to finish the CA course, right? But what they don't realize is you get those extra 1-2 years to probably build a really good social life, which will hold you in good stead for the next 40-50 years. Yeah. So they probably, the earliest possible way to finish the course is in 4 years, right? Mm-hmm. Not to probably brag about it, but I did go to college and do the same thing. Okay. A lot of people probably tend to stay at home. They feel that if they do not go to college, they have more time on their hands to probably study, clear the course in a very good time. And I would sadly, I'd respectfully disagree with them, because I think more than just clearing the course, your social life and the friend circle that you build right in college, and you guys must be able to relate to that, considering that you go to an engineering college, I think it's extremely important. And this notion of just finishing the course in 4 years without going to college should be broken down. I think it's something that shouldn't be done, at least. One more thing is people tend to pursue correspondence degrees, which is essentially, if you've heard of IGNO, right? So Indira Gandhi National Open University.
Correct.
They just probably have a BCom correspondence degree where they go write an exam once in 6 months just for the degree tag of it. But that doesn't serve the purpose. The purpose of college is to meet and, the whole point of networking, right?
Yeah.
Which is sadly missed out on by a lot of CA aspirants, at least.
So I have another follow-up question to that. And I think I know from now onwards, I know even you are consciously aware of it, that Anirudh Ramesh is going to be synonymous to All India Rank 28. I know there's a certain bliss to it, to associated with it. I want to take you to the thoughts that you had after you achieved that, rank. You know, just try to elaborate the kind of emotions that you've gone through, and you know, how do you feel associated with the rank from now onwards?
Yeah, sure. I'm sorry to intervene, but I wanted to ask this question, and it was like firing up inside me. Has the All India Rank 28 become a second part of your surname? Has it always come with your name now on, since you achieved it?
I mean, I don't think it's supposed to be that way, to be honest. But I think people do take me up that way in terms of, okay, this guy is done. He's gotten a rank. So let me look at him in a different manner, right? But I'd respectfully ask people not to do that, because you can achieve it, but that doesn't probably stay. I mean, it's probably something important for the first job that you land. But after that, it kind of should go away, because what defines your next role is what you've done in the current role that I'm in. So I'd probably say that this rank is there for the next 1 or 2 years. After that, it will take a backseat, right? So I probably would say that. And coming to Abhinav's question in terms of, I'll take you back a year and a half when I finished my intermediate and did my articleship. So CA final is a good 2.5-3 year journey, like I mentioned. So I was writing my exams in November 2020, probably about 6-7 months ago. But my preparations had started in May 2019. So it was a good 18-month journey, right? Mm-hmm. So 18-month journey in the sense, I had to wake up. So articleship or the work I did at Deloitte, what it's called, is from 11 a.m. in the morning till whenever they probably let you go home. So that was 11 to probably... So it's a myth that you work 45 hours in a week. You end up working 60, 70. So 11 a.m. to probably 8, 9 p.m. every day, right? Uh-huh. And then every day in the morning, I would take out my scooter in chilly Bangalore weather, travel 11, 12 kilometers to go to class at 5:45 in the morning. I think it was, I leave my home at 5:45, start at 6:15, come back home at 9, 10 in the night, do the same thing for 7 days a week.
Right.
And on Sundays, the classes were the whole day, because it's Sunday, you're not expected to work, you're expected to study because you're a CA student, right? So the whole part of it. But luckily, I did manage to have a little bit of a social life. Friends, I probably didn't meet everyone I wanted to, but Saturday evenings were exclusively left to meet people and friends. Right? Okay. So that happened. So the whole journey started off with 12 months of classes, 5 a.m. to 10 p.m. the whole day going around. And after that, you get a 6-month study break. So I was lucky enough to be working at Deloitte, where they give us a study break of 6 months to prepare for your exams. And it's a paid leave. So I literally... So how articleship works is you get something called a stipend. So you get 20-25K a month for working with them. So I was lucky enough, just before the pandemic set in, my study leave started. Okay. So I was off, probably right when the pandemic started. So April 2020 to November was my study leave, right? Mm-hmm. And I was lucky enough to be in Chennai at home, where my family is currently. Because, so I think March 21st was when India announced a lockdown. Right. So I stay in Chennai. My dad literally calls me up at 10 p.m. the previous day. He expects a lockdown, an interstate movement to be shut the next day, right? If people who know the geography, he comes from Chennai to Hosur to pick me up at 4 a.m. the next day morning. Okay. I literally leave all my things in my flat in Bangalore. Mm-hmm. I come to Hosur at 5, 6 a.m. and I come to Chennai. Right. Mm-hmm. And this was March 21st, 2020. All my books, my CA books, everything is in Bangalore. Mm-hmm. And I'm in Chennai. Okay. The pandemic is set in, lockdowns have happened, and everything is in Bangalore. Right. And my exams are happening in 6 months. Huh. So I start freaking out, because for me, my books are my everything. Like, they're my baby. I've done so much of hard work over the last 12 months, writing class notes, attending classes every day religiously, that it felt very different to not have my books with me. So then we had them couriered from there and all of that. But one very important aspect I'd like to probably point out is my dad's, his thinking that a lockdown is about to set in. So he traveled 300 odd kilometers to come pick me up.
Right.
So hats off to that. And apart from that, so that's when the journey started for the study leave aspect, right? 6 months studying probably 10, 12 hours a day, barely spending any time with family, because the whole day is gone by studying. And apart from that, so when you finish these exams, right? So your exams, what happens in CA exams is you have a 2-week span. You have 8 papers where you have one paper every alternate day. Mm-hmm. So it happens in the afternoon. You have a 1.5 day gap and you write the next paper. And this goes on for 8 specific papers. So the amount of pressure and stress that you go through, right, in this entire journey is insane. In the sense mm-hmm. that by the time the 8th paper is done, all you want to do is probably get a beer and just sit. Like you really want, yeah. you really want to chill out. Right?
Chill out, yeah.
Yeah.
So my whole journey till then was hectic, hectic, hectic. Exams got over. For 2 months, I didn't do anything. I would sit in my room, open Hotstar or Netflix and just binge watch shows because I think I deserved that phase where I had done so much of hard work over the last 1.5 years. I would just chill. So right. I went to Bangalore. I went to Coorg. I partied a little bit, all of that. Okay. Then the results came in probably February 1st, 2021. Right.
Okay.
So
okay.
I had a feeling that, so 400 marks is the passing mark for CA final. And I had a feeling that I'll get 410, 420 because that was, I had a feeling that I'll pass and I'll just scrape through, right?
Mm-hmm.
And when the results came, I didn't see a 4 there. Like they show an accumulative marks card, I didn't see a 4. So I freaked out, right? And I saw a 5, which meant it was a 500 score. Right? And that got me, so I was on my bed lying down, just checking my scores.
Right.
My dad was asleep in the other room.
Right.
It was in the afternoon. So I was so freaked out the whole week. I barely slept the whole night. So I would just stay awake till 4 a.m., not be able to sleep, pass out at 4 because of tiredness, wake up at 12 in the afternoon. So on the 1st of Feb, the results came around 1 p.m. Mm-hmm. And that was when I had just woken up actually because super stressed out. I woke up around 12:31, the results came out and I saw a 500 something score. And then it hit me that, okay, I've passed. I'm a chartered accountant today, which is insane. But I also did something better than I expected because I never expected a rank to start off.
Right.
So that whole feeling of getting, and then, so you have 2 marks card. One is your marks card, which is score. Mm-hmm. And then you have a separate marks card with a rank.
Okay.
So I was like, okay, I have a 536. If I don't remember how much I got, 536. And then I went to the second portal to check my rank. And then it said 28. And that's when I lost it because it's been something I've, and then the whole story that I've taken you through now, right? That flashed before my eyes in probably 20 seconds. And I was like, shit, this is something I've actually crossed the barrier for. Mm-hmm. And it was insane. It felt too good to be true. And it still feels too good to be true because I know the mistakes I've made on the journey, right?
Yeah.
And the whole aspect and the part of it is people don't realize that you can make tens of thousands of mistakes and still end up in a good place. They feel that everything has to be aligned or, you know, like the dominoes that fall. It's possible that one falls and the second doesn't fall, right? And you could still become or, you know, reach a really good place.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. So I think that's what happened with me as well. So extremely glad to be in the place I am today.
Yeah.
Now that you mentioned you were able to give a very, very elaborate, ride on the entire emotional journey towards it, I wanted to touch on a very, very personal thing. Okay. What is personal is the burnout that is very, 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 people go through the burnout. Could you share a bit of that? Like you mentioned, like 18 months of slogging, just 18 hours a day. I want you to touch on the burnout aspect of this area. And perhaps I know this is unfair to ask, say for example, it did not work out this time. Would you think we would have been able to do another 18 year cycle of this entire entire hard work and entire, you know, CA attempt once again? Because I know you must be aware of the burnout that people go through, you know, 3-4 attempts and just, you know, people kind of lose hope because understandably it's a very hard exam. So what do you think of that?
So the 18 month journey is a one-time thing because once I write my November exams, so the exams happen in May and November every year. So if I did not clear my November 20, I had a chance to write in May 21. Right. Mm. So it's a 6-month cycle. Mm. So the whole study period goes on again for 6 more months. If I did not clear it, right, I would have been, I would have been really, really upset with myself and with the whole journey because anyone expects to put in, say, X number of effort to get Y amount of rewards, right? And understandably that if someone who's put in the same amount of effort as I have and someone who's not cleared, then they're visibly upset or annoyed with how the outcome was. So fingers, touch wood, it didn't go that way. I probably do not. I'll be honest. I don't know how I would have been or how I would have taken it. Because, see, to be honest, ever since school, right? I've been someone who's gotten decent grades. Not been someone who's just scraped through exams, right? So for someone like that, having cleared the first two levels as well in the first attempt, I was not ready to experience failure. Honestly, like I didn't want to not clear my exams at the last moment in the final hurdle, because this plays a big part in your resume. Let's be honest, like at least to get your first job, right? Maybe down the line, 10 years down the line, people will know you're a CA, but to land your first job and to get a decent enough pay package, clearing it in the first attempt really does help. I'll put it out there. It is a myth that it doesn't work out, but it actually does matter. Mm-hmm. At least for your first job. So if you ask me, would I have been really hurt? I would have been extremely hurt. Like I would probably been in my room like for two whole months, if you ask me.
Mm-hmm. Right. Before we began the podcast, you mentioned a little bit about the cultural shock that you had moving from Chennai to Bangalore. I don't know if I'm very genuine enough to mention, because I think that was the time my internet connection also went off for a quick second. But you mentioned a little bit about the cultural shock that you had, and you overcame that, and then you made connections and network, and then social life became a part of your journey as well. And how would you brief that in a little 2 to 3 minute, or however you would like to summarize that journey? Okay.
So I was mentioning about how I was pursuing, I applied for the BBA course, Bachelor's in Business Administration, along with ACCA, which is CA, but from UK. Okay. A different kind of a global accounting program. Mm-hmm. And that didn't work through. That didn't go through. Mm-hmm. And I got to know that, like I said, in the second week of July approximately. So Christ was a temporary thing I started off with, where I had moved to Bangalore to my aunt's house. So my aunt's house, it was a big 2 BHK, but there was no one there. They had moved mm-hmm. to Chennai. So I had the house to myself. And this was about 10, 12 kilometers away from college. Right. So it was extremely difficult for me, because I've always felt a little inferior. I'm not sure if I was supposed to feel that way, coming from South India to a place where I didn't know Hindi back then. My Hindi wasn't great. Mm. So in a city like Bangalore, I feel a lot of people connect over Hindi because it's a lot of population from the north, right? And I felt I needed to establish myself, and I wanted to be a part of that community, as in terms of being, I mean, otherwise I'm just restricting myself to probably 40% of the population to become friends with.
Correct.
Because there is a language barrier.
Correct.
So for me, that culture shock was a big thing. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a culture shock per se. It was more of a culture welcoming thing, because mm-hmm. I had moved from a conservative mindset / place to a place which is very open. Mm-hmm. So a place like Bangalore, which I love the city, right? Let's mm-hmm. put it out there. Like mm-hmm. if there's a place I wanted to be in India right now, I love staying at home. No offense to my family and everything, but I love Bangalore, right? Because it's made me the person I am today. So just continue with. So I stayed for a good 2 months in my aunt's house, and I had to meet people, travel every day for 10 kilometers. And it was a difficult time because I actually lost close to 14 kgs in weight that time, because it was a huge change. So I went from like 85 to like 70 kgs, if I'm not wrong. So everyone was worried about how I was looking, why I was looking so thin and all of that. So that was a very big change, not necessarily associated with culture shock itself. But after that, I can understand Hindi perfectly now, although I can't really speak, right? So a lot of people feel that because you are from South India, people shouldn't impose Hindi on you to learn, right? But if you want to be a part of the community and you want to expand your friend zone, I think it's necessary. Like, you're living in a country where the majority of people do know the language and speak it. While it's definitely not mandatory, if you want to make friends, if you want to probably expand your social circle, please know the language. It really helps. So in the last 3-4 years, at least in the first 2 years in Bangalore, that was what I focused on. To how do I come out of my shell, being from a conservative place, and mm-hmm. become someone who's able to establish not his authority, but establish his friendship and his and a good social circle in Christ in Bangalore, because it has people from all walks of life. It has 30% from the Gulf, 30% from North India, 20% from Bangalore, and 20% from everywhere, right? So it was a hodgepodge of everything that came together. And I would say that has been the best part, because I think I've met so many people from, say, Jaipur, Indore, Jharkhand, the Gulf, right? So when you get that exposure at a pretty young age, when I was 18, I was 17 when I went to college, right? So 17 and a half, 18. So when you get that, I think your mind opens up. You have actually gone from someone who didn't know that there's a world outside of Chennai to someone who's seen the whole world, or at least what I think is the whole world. So like, that was a very, very nice experience, at least in college.
Mm-hmm. Right. So I had something to ask. When you mentioned that Christ University is a boiling pot of, you know, all the cultures of India, it's like a pan-Indian experience in itself. There also is, like, I know this was something I personally wanted to know from your side, was what you felt was like, you know, you need to establish some mental clarity to also know that you're trying to pursue a chartered accountancy exam along with trying to juggle 2-3 different balls at the same time, right? Like trying to integrate into the culture, trying to integrate into the society, trying to learn a new language, trying to learn a third language, which is more important to say, trying to learn a third language altogether. I can personally understand because I have been in the same position and I have tried to integrate into the culture and trying to learn a third language. This is a huge part of this podcast trying to begin. So what do you think about, you mentioned something on the lines of, I wish I was asked this before, but it's better that you can answer it right now. What you knew then, but you know it right now. Like what you didn't know it then, but you know it right now. And you know, I would want you to touch a little bit on that as well, you know. At the same time, sure. Trying to maintain how did you think of maintaining that mental clarity? I was very curious of that.
Yeah.
Sure. So I think for me, it started off with understanding. Like if there's something I would tell my 17-year-old self, right? Like I'm 22 today. So I'd probably tell myself to talk and be open to as many people as possible, because I feel that I've judged people for certain behavioral characteristics of theirs, right? Yeah. And no offense to anyone out there, I've always felt that some people from certain parts of the country are pretty loud, right? I'm not putting out names, but or regions, but those people are the most fun. So there's no point probably ignoring someone because they're loud when they can be one of the most fun-loving people you've come across, right? So my first experience was probably breaking those shackles and understanding people as who they are genuinely. And that is something that I did not do in the beginning, at least for the first 1-2 years in college, right? I would judge someone because they were not similar to how I was or how I expected someone to be. And that is something that I changed probably after I matured, in my third year of college or after I graduated as well. And I would have probably made more friends and retained more friends if I'd known this back then. So that is something I'd probably like to tell. And a lot of people don't probably ask me, why did you go to Christ and go to a regular college? So to be honest, I didn't want to go to a boys' college in Chennai. I wanted to go to a co-education college. So a lot of people think I went to Christ because that was the only option I had. It was because I didn't want to go to a boys' college in Chennai. And a lot of people don't know this. So that's what happened with the Christ story. And another aspect that you touched upon in terms of multitasking, I think that's what you were referring to, right? In terms of how did a lot of things happen at the same time, at the same place. It was a nightmare. I had so many things going on at the same time. It was difficult to handle work as well. Like I mentioned, articleship, right? In my third year of college, I was part of heading one of the college fests along with handling work. So there was a phase where I actually did mess up with work. You can't be 100% or even 90% at both the places, right? So I did get a few backlashes at work because I was constantly picking up calls from the organizing team at college. They would be doing the groundwork. I would be at office picking up calls the whole day, right? So to people out there who are pursuing something which are completely different from each other at the same time, you have to expect backlashes. You have to expect that people will not be entirely happy with the output. But that is a part of the process. Because while you grow up, while you finish and you graduate, right, you have to hustle after that. So this just prepares you for the journey. You might have multiple things happening which are completely different. And I think the college part, along with managing a fest, having friends, and attending work at Deloitte, probably prepared me for the whole journey. While multitasking is difficult, it is not impossible.
And it's helpful for your mainstream goal or your mainstream achievement or something, right?
Definitely. It probably helps you take out time. I mean, it helps you reflect on what you've been doing so far as well, right? Because you've done, say, ABC things. And then at the end of the day, you realize that you've actually contributed to some output. And that really matters. It's not like you're just a part of it for the heck of it. You have done some tangible visual thing that comes out from your efforts. And that felt really nice, at least in college and at Deloitte work.
Right.
To end our podcast on a high note, I would like to ask one last question, which is like, if you were to, I think we wanted to touch on the mental clarity aspect. You mentioned something on the lines of there are a lot of people that you meet in Bangalore, right? Unfortunately, that you would also come across a lot of people who would kind of pull you down to trying to achieve something you would want to achieve. Like, and we personally experience it as well as, you know, I mean, everybody experienced it at some point in their life, because I know we would want to assume that would happen eventually, because if you want to do something very seriously, right? How would you have dealt with such experience, like, you know, trying to develop the mental stamina to come across these people at the same time trying to see these several things? And, you know, how would you reflect on that? I would want to know your thoughts on that.
I think that's a great question, something that I've probably not given a lot of thought towards as well, right? In the sense that, because, I mean, I think it's a very mature question to ask, honestly. I would probably say that you have to start identifying these people, but you also tend to label these people at a very early stage, right? Which shouldn't happen. Like, people could be well-wishers, but then you label them as someone who's trying to push you down, right? Which might not be the case. So what I've done, and I've personally experienced this in the past as well, is give them their own space, but try staying away as much as possible. In the sense that if they want to achieve something that you've already achieved, or if they are someone who's trying to overdo something and push you down, right? Stay away. And this clarity will come once you have experiences in this manner over the last 2, 3, 4 years, right? There could be a few rotten apples in every basket, but that doesn't mean that everyone's trying to do the same thing. So I don't have a particular personal experience that I want to bring out here in terms of getting pushed down. So, I mean, I'm not really sure what I would do or what I've done in the past is at least tell these people or tell the circle around me that I'm trying to stay away from, say, X person or Y person for these reasons. And they tend to evaluate that person better, because sometimes you have personal biases against some person, right? So I always have this set of 3-4 close friends who I talk about my problems to, about, say, a person's behavior or Y person's behavior. And I ask them to take a choice for me, because a collective response from people who I trust and who are my confidants really helps, right? Because I think a personal opinion might be weighed down by your personal bias at the end of the day. So probably talk about it to 2, 3, 4 people and then take a call.
For sure. Yeah, that's a well thought. That's a well thought. I think that's something we should do at a personal level. Ourselves,
that was very insightful.
Yeah.
Yeah, especially when you mentioned you would want, it's important and better to take a more collective opinion and, you know, try to discuss it with your confidants instead of just, you know, because the whole concept of the whole concept of personal bias really comes into picture. And you hit the nail on that part.
Right. Because for example, if I'm playing like cricket with someone, right, and that guy gets me out, then I don't like him. That doesn't mean he's not a nice person ultimately. Right.
Right.
So it's possible that my friend probably hit a six against him. So it's a different story, right? So I probably have to talk to 3-4 people and then take a decision.
Right. Right. I feel like I should have taken a popcorn break or something and then come back and had a second half of the discussion or something. But thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining with us today. And I know in the beginning we mentioned 30 to 35 minutes, but we ended up discussing 40 minutes plus. And that only shows how good the discussion was and how rich the conversations we had. So thank you so much for joining us today. And thank you for being such a sport and being a part of our casually serious journey. And thank you everyone else who's watching the episode on YouTube and hearing it on various other audio platforms. And we'll see you next week with a new guest.